Hello there.
Star Wars Revenge of the Sith is the third and final Star Wars film in the prequel trilogy, which in a lot of ways I would say is the best of the three, although it still has its fair share of issues. This film was the first film in the series that was rated PG-13, and it doesn't feel like it's just a gimmick to make people think this film is dark and edgy, which to be fair, it is. This film feels like it has an intentional darkness to it, which I think is necessary to show Anakin's transition into Vader. That isn't to say it's a well-executed aspect of the film. It is very fair to call that aspect rushed, but it is what it is. I think the general consensus is that this is the best of the prequels, and I'd agree with that sentiment mostly, although the general pacing and dialogue issues really hold me back from calling this a good film. Hell, I've even seen fans call this the best Star Wars film, which is a statement I would call downright wrong. Well, it's fine to have your own opinion, I wholeheartedly disagree with that statement. That said, I don't think the Why It Sucks title is entirely fair, because I don't think it sucks per se, it's just very far from good in my opinion. Anyhow, with that out of the way, let's get into the plot.
It's over, Anakin! I have the
plot.
This film starts with a pretty neat sequence of Anakin and Obi-Wan racing through space to get to the Trade Federation ship, which has Chancellor Palpatine on board. Apparently, he was captured between the events of Attack of the Clones and this movie. Anyhow, they enter the ship and find Palpatine, only to be forced into a duel with Count Dooku. Obi-Wan is injured, but Anakin manages to kill Dooku with some prompting from Palpatine.
Do it.
Anyhow, they try to escape the ship when they are captured by the new secondary bad guy in this film and merchandising Marvel, General Grievous. Anyhow, they fight, Grievous gets away, and they crash land the ship on Coruscant. Here, Anakin learns that Padme is pregnant and they are about to have a child, but he starts having nightmares that Padme will die during childbirth. This, added to the fact that the Jedi Council wants Anakin to spy on his friend and clearly evil mentor Chancellor Palpatine, leads to Anakin having second thoughts about the Jedi Order.
This is outrageous. It's unfair.
Anyhow, the movie has Obi-Wan and Yoda go off-planet for plot convenience reasons so that it's easier for old Palps to try to seduce Anakin to the dark side. He tells Anakin about Darth Plagueis, who can conveniently save people from death with his dark force power.
He could even keep the ones he cared about from dying.
And Anakin is intrigued, but doesn't put two and two together and realize that this motherfucker is evil until like two scenes later when Palpatine outright admits it.
Learn to know the dark side of the Force, and you will be able to save your wife from certain death.
What did you say?
Anyways, he tells Mace Windu, who's like, shit, that's messed up, but I'll arrest him, so you wait here. And Mace goes with a small team of three other Jedi to capture Palpatine. Why he wouldn't tell any other Jedi is a mystery to me, but whatever, that's what happens in the film. Anyhow, Anakin has a good cry and shows up to see Mace about to kill Palpatine, and Anakin decides fuck it and kills Mace Windu. He tells Palpatine he'll join him to save Padme, and Palpatine's like, yeah, so we can figure out that whole saving people from dying thing.
Just help me save Padme's life. I can't live without her.
To cheat death is a power only one has achieved, but if we work together, I know we can discover the secret.
Now, rather than being a sane person and saying, wait, I thought you promised to save her, he just goes along with it, and Palpatine orders him to slaughter everyone in the Jedi Temple, especially the children.
Master Skywalker, there are too many of them. What are we going to do?
Okay, so Palpatine orders a number 66, and this prompts every Jedi to be easily killed by all the clone troopers. Then, Anakin heads off to kill the Trade Federation and deactivate the battle droids to conveniently explain why they're not in the original trilogy. Oh yeah, while this all goes on, Obi-Wan kills Grievous. What an important character that certainly wasn't in this film exclusively to sell toys. Okay, meanwhile, Obi-Wan meets up with Yoda, and they find out Anakin is evil now, and they're like, looks like we need to kill him and Palpatine, I guess. So they head their separate ways to kill Palpatine and Anakin, while Palpatine takes over the galaxy by telling the Senate that the Jedi are evil, but he killed them all, so now he's Space Hitler. Alright, so Obi-Wan is on Mustafar and fights Anakin in this prolonged battle, while Yoda confronts Palpatine and fights him in a prolonged battle. Yoda is defeated and flees, but Obi-Wan gets the high ground on Anakin and slices him up. and he gets lit on fire, explaining why he's a cyborg man instead of a handsome male model in the original films. Padme dies, but she has Luke and Leia before she passes. Obi-Wan gives Luke to Uncle Owen, and Bail Organa takes Leia because he was conveniently considering adopting a daughter.
We've always talked of adopting a baby girl. She will be loved with us.
The film ends with Anakin, now Vader, in his brand new Vader suit, watching the construction of the Death Star. The end.
It's over, Anakin! I have the
characters.
This film has a lot of characters, much like the previous films, but it really puts the focus where it should be, squarely on Anakin, Obi-Wan, and Palpatine, with a little Yoda sprinkled in there for good measure. I'm not going to talk about Chewbacca in this slide because he isn't super important, but I'm still confused as to why he's in this film as like a Wookiee general or something. Like, I'd be completely cool with him being in the war as like an Easter egg in the background, but the fact that Yoda literally says to Chewbacca something around the lines of "I will miss you, old friend," is pretty cringe and a little too on the nose for me to handle.
Goodbye, Chewbacca. Miss you, I will.
Anyways, he also looks like shit in this movie. Like, what the fuck did they do to him? He looks scary. Anyways, fuck it, let's get into our characters. Anakin. In this film, Anakin starts the film off like he's the best guy ever, who never murdered children just one installment ago. He's saving Obi-Wan when he didn't have to, he saves clones when they're basically disposable non-people in this universe, literally bred for war, which I have to assume is against the Geneva Convention, but it's okay because that doesn't exist in Star Wars. Point is, he starts as a really good guy. Then he kind of just becomes evil for no good reason and loses any trace of a character he once had. Like, I get he wanted to save Padme, but he's gonna become an evil child killer because Palpatine told him,
"Learn to know the dark side of the Force, and you will be able to save your wife from certain death."
The only other motivating factor is the fact that the Council made him spy on Palpatine, who revealed he was lying and secretly evil space Hitler who orchestrated the death of millions of people. They wouldn't make him a master as well, I guess, but none of this seems to warrant the 180 change of character, especially since earlier in the film he was a nice, caring guy. It's just stupid and horribly done. What if in the space scene at the start, Obi-Wan, a good uncorruptible character, went to save the clones and Anakin said something like, "No, let them die, we have more important things to do at this time," rather than what happens in the film where Obi-Wan's basically telling Anakin to let them die and Anakin goes back to save these people?
They're all over me!
I'm gonna go help them out.
No!
No, they are doing their job.
Then we can do ours.
This wouldn't be wholeheartedly evil, but shows that he's less compassionate for life. Hell, this would make his turn 10 times more believable since it would show how Anakin wants to do what he thinks is right at any cost, thus him turning against the Jedi for what he views as the greater good, which would make a lot more sense. Maybe Obi-Wan could comment on how he's changed and turned much darker, and he fears what's happening to him. The prequel films all have years in between each installment. It would be fine if Anakin became darker off-screen, as long as that's clearly telegraphed to the audience with a scene like that, where it shows that Anakin's a little more ruthless and is a little more duty-driven than what we've seen in previous installments. But George couldn't figure that out, so he just decided that Anakin will suddenly turn to an evil school shooter with very little prompting. Padme is pretty much still a plot device over a character. She literally just sits around and says, "I'm pregnant," then is used for a tool for Palpatine to manipulate Anakin. Nothing more, nothing less, just a plot device. Obi-Wan is mostly solid in this film. I mean, he still kind of has that stoic Jedi vibe he had in the last film, but they flesh him out a bit more, giving him some emotion. Clearly, he cares about Anakin, and he seems to have some charisma in this film. Still, he kind of just sits around and dicks off on his side quest with mini-boss General Grievous till the last third of the movie, so I feel like he was still a bit of a missed opportunity. Like, maybe somehow incorporate him into the Palpatine confrontation scene, and ultimately Anakin sides with Palpatine over Obi-Wan. Maybe that would have been cool, but I don't know, whatever. Speaking of Grievous, he's in this movie to sell toys. He has forearm action to hold up multiple lightsabers, and even though we don't really see him do anything of note, trust me, he's strong. I mean, the man has four lightsabers and can swing them around really fast. He also has a hamster wheel car thing for toy set action. I mean, it's not like he's just gonna be easily killed, like, three scenes after he's introduced by Obi-Wan or anything. Fuck it, it must have worked though. When I was a kid, I had like three toys of this guy. I loved General Grievous. Now I see him for what he is, a cool thing designed for merchandising the Star Wars franchise. Yoda is a stoic Jedi who is really strong and good at fighting, but gets sad when Anakin becomes evil. I can't think of anything else to describe the character or his arc in this film. If you can come up with any more ideas of what this character is in this film, leave a comment below and tell me, because I'm at a loss for words on what this character's relevance was to the film, besides explaining exactly how and why he's on Dagobah in Empire Strikes Back. Mace Windu's a big meanie head who won't let Anakin be a Jedi Master and is leading the Jedi Master gossip against Palpatine. Also, Mace Windu, for the love of God, why would you only bring 3 Jedi to confront Palpatine, the ultimate evil Sith Lord? This all could have been easily solved if he brought like 20 guys. Yeah, sure, some of them would have died, but whatever, it's a worthy sacrifice to get this guy. He's the ultimate Sith Lord. Hell, this was kind of an issue in Episode 1 as well, with all those hundreds if not thousands of Jedi you couldn't have even bothered to send like 10 or 20 to fight Maul, or 5 or 10 to fight Grievous, or 20 or 30 to fight Palpatine. What the hell are they doing all day? And I know some are off-planet, but I think like 7 or 8 of the council members were still in the room, and I'm sure a handful were just sitting around jerking off or whatever Jedi do with their spare time. Bring an army, Mace. What the hell are you doing anyway? Palpatine is pure evil and he doesn't even try to hide it. He wants unlimited power just for the fuck of it. He likes zapping people, he hates Jedi, and wants them all dead for the fuck of it. That's about it. He's crazy and fun to watch. Yeah, I love Palpatine in this film. Even though he looks like my shaved ballsack mixed with Bram Stoker's Dracula for the last half of the runtime. Also, what was with the weird filter they put on Palpatine's voice?
Trust you, my young apprentice. I believe you are the only Jedi with no knowledge of this plot.
I love everything about Palpatine in this film, and I hate everything about Palpatine in this film at the same time. It's an interesting contradiction, I suppose.
It's over, Anakin! I have the
CGI and special effects.
This film relies on special effects perhaps a bit too much like the previous film, but at least the CGI is worlds better than Attack of the Clones. Even from the first ship battle, it's clear they upped their CGI game, but on top of that, the environments look better. Like when they're sitting in CGI rooms, or even when they're in CGI heavy planets like Kashyyyk. General Grievous also holds up very well in this film, a hell of a lot better than Jar Jar does in The Phantom Menace, that's for sure. And even in 4K, he doesn't feel too much like a CG character. Well, I think the new Disney movies look better than this one, in part because the CGI had a decade to advance between the release of this one and The Force Awakens, and the heavier reliance on practical effects with the creatures. I still think this film looks mostly nice for a CG-heavy feature. I think the only thing that really hit on my uncanny valley senses is when Anakin and Obi-Wan landed on the Separatist ship CGI hangar. For some reason, my brain thought that looked really fake. But otherwise, it's a vast improvement from the last film and still outpaces some major releases of today, in terms of effects.
It's over, Anakin! I have the
pacing.
Well, I think the CG is a huge improvement. Much like the other prequels, the pacing is less than good. It is about as long as Attack of the Clones and isn't nearly as boring as that, but a good portion of this film is just mind-numbing action or mind-numbing boring shit. They really fail to find a middle ground. The first 15 minutes is really fun, action-packed, balls-to-the-wall scene. There are heroes running around, battle droids are getting diced up, lightsabers are everywhere, ships are blowing up, and it's a ton of fun. Then it hits the boring shit, where nothing happens for an hour but exposition leading to Anakin's quick change into the dark side. And while there is some action, the action we see doesn't involve characters we care about, so it's kinda just there. The Wookiees fight the droids, that looked cool, but who are any of these characters? So ultimately, the second act of this film is just exposition, which is boring as fuck. The final act is when Anakin is evil, so everything this movie has to say has already been said, and the rest is just shooting, and fighting, and lightsabers, and magic force powers, and it gets fucking old. Like, the Yoda-Palpatine fight could have been cool if it was like a battle of the Force, but it's mostly just a lightsaber fight. And meanwhile, we also have Anakin and Obi-Wan's lightsaber fight, which could have been cool, but they're just doing ridiculous shit, like Tarzan swinging around, climbing up buildings, and screaming nonsense at each other.
If you're not with me, then you're my enemy.
Only a Sith deals in absolutes. I will do what I must.
You will try.
Both of those scenes look good and have fun moments, but they need to be cut down and changed a bit conceptually in my eyes. Though I will note Yoda and Palpatine's fight needs a lot more work than the Anakin-Obi-Wan fight, but the Anakin-Obi-Wan fight definitely could have been trimmed down or something, maybe cut out some of the ridiculous aspects of that scene and kind of just keep, like, the meat of the fighting and less of the CGI building climbing and Tarzan swinging, etc. I still think the best fight in this franchise has to be Luke and Vader's Death Star fight. It has action, emotion, and exposition like Anakin and Obi-Wan's, but it doesn't get ridiculous like that fight or overstay its welcome like the Obi-Wan-Anakin fight. Overall, Revenge of the Sith has a lot of good stuff from its themes to its story beats. It's just weirdly rushed for some beats, prolonged for others, and fails to find a good balance between action and exposition. Also, I'm just going to throw this side note in here because I don't know where else to put it, but why doesn't Obi-Wan and Yoda team up on the Emperor and then Anakin? Obi-Wan beats Anakin, and Yoda almost beats the Emperor, so I assume if Obi-Wan and Yoda teamed up on the Emperor together, they would have pretty easily won. Then they could have just flown over and taken out Anakin as well. Obi-Wan was able to defeat him alone. I don't know how Yoda being there would do anything but help. Also, why didn't Obi-Wan just kill Anakin? He crippled him, watched him start on fire, and was just like, he's probably gonna die. I'm just gonna go. Like, it was your friend. You could at least kill the guy so he doesn't have to burn to death or starve to death slowly. I don't know, would have been nice of him, rather than just letting his friend die a slow, painful death or letting him be saved and become an evil cyborg man, but whatever, I guess.
It's over, Anakin! I have the
weird dialogue.
This film is filled to the goddamn brim with some of the most bizarre dialogue I've ever heard. It is honestly simultaneously what makes this movie so infinitely rewatchable to me, while also being the biggest reason this movie is bad. The list is almost endless, and my friends and I constantly throw quotes from this movie into everyday conversations. Even ones that aren't huge fans of Star Wars or the series know exactly what I'm talking about and love to quote them with me. You know how in like every series there's that one quotable line that's so funny and stupid you just laugh hysterically when you hear it? Yeah, that's literally every line in this film. Here's a clip show of some of my favorite lines.
Wait a minute. How did this happen? We're smarter than this.
Apparently not.
Another happy landing.
Do it. We must get off this ship before it's too late.
He seems to be all right.
Leave him or we'll never make it.
Did you ever hear the tragedy of Darth Plagueis the Wise?
It's a Sith legend.
Darth Plagueis was a dark lord of the Sith, so powerful and so wise, he could use the Force to influence the midichlorians to create life. He had such a knowledge of the dark side, he could even keep the ones he cared about from dying.
Hello there.
It's only because I'm so in love.
No. No, it's because I'm so in love with you.
So love has blinded you?
Master Skywalker, there are too many of them. What are we going to do?
I have seen her. A security hologram of him killing younglings.
A Sith Lord?
The oppression of the Sith will never return.
No. 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 You must die! He's a traitor!
He is a traitor!
All I want is your love.
Love won't save you, Padme. Only my new powers can do that.
I have brought peace, freedom, justice, and security to my new empire.
Your new empire?
Don't make me kill you. If you're not with me, then you're my enemy.
Only a Sith deals in absolutes.
It's over, Anakin! I have the high ground! It's over, Anakin! I have the
conclusion.
Well, that was the Star Wars prequels. Overall, they're pretty fucking bad. But with that said, I don't hate them, and they're fun to watch, with the exception of Attack of the Clones. They have a lot of funny moments, and they do add a lot of cool lore to the Star Wars brand. I like the new ships, I don't hate the battle droids, I like a lot of the Jedi introduced, I like how these films are in the same universe as the original trilogy, but very distinctive, and in a very different time period, being very nice looking and not as industrial as in the original trilogy. George Lucas is a bad director, but a creative genius helping curate this crazy new world, which I think adds more to the Star Wars lore than the original trilogy, which laid the groundwork well, but didn't have the technology to expand it to the point we see in this trilogy. And hell, it's impossible to say this series didn't add more than the sequel trilogy, that's literally just the original trilogy again, basically. So while these films don't have inspired cinematography, has an overabundance of CGI, has the shittiest of shit tier dialogue and overall sloppy direction, it still has a lot of fun and cool moments. While these films do suck, they have a special place in my heart, and that's pretty neat, I suppose. Anyhow, now that we're done with that, it's time to move over to the Disney Star Wars prequels, so we'll be looking at Solo and Rogue One next. But so I don't get totally burned out, and because I have like 200 movies I plan on reviewing on this show, next week we'll be looking at something else, and then the following week we'll get back to it with Solo. Like, subscribe, whatever else, share this video, comment, I read all my comments, so call me a fat fuck or whatever, and I'll give the comment a big ol' NTMA heart.